While we have been lost in the cyclical agenda of politics and gossip, astronomers have discovered that asteroids in space not only contain the conditions necessary for life, but also the fundamental components of life, many of which existed even before Earth was formed. Notice, I'm not saying on Earth, but in the rocks of outer space, which greatly increases the possibility of life beyond our planet. Have you heard about this discovery? If you have, do you truly understand what was discovered and why it's such an extraordinary find? Gather around, and you'll understand now. Let's talk about asteroids. You may or may not remember, but in 2016, NASA launched a spacecraft called Osiris-Rex. Its mission was to travel to an asteroid, land on it, collect samples, and bring those samples back to Earth. This is an extraordinary mission in every way. I've explained before, in the video about Pluto's planet status, why they went to an asteroid instead of a planet or moon. Asteroids are like snapshots of the early moments of the solar system, as most of them never evolved into larger celestial bodies, like planets or dwarf planets. But here's the issue. How do we study asteroids? How can we research an asteroid? After all, we can't just look at it from here and know what's happening on its surface. Currently, there are two known ways to study them. The first is to wait for an asteroid to fall to Earth. The biggest problem here is that there are very few asteroids whose paths intersect with Earth, and even fewer are interesting. Over the last 4.5 billion years, Earth has already cleared most of the asteroids that once crossed its path. Furthermore, most asteroids don't even reach the Earth's surface. They burn up in the atmosphere as meteors. Even worse, the few that manage to reach the surface can have their structure altered due to the extreme heat they experience while entering the atmosphere, making it difficult for researchers to analyze them or even find the exact location of their landing. Or, by the time researchers find the site, contamination from Earth-based life can alter the samples, which makes it nearly impossible, though not always, to separate the organic material or bacteria that may have accumulated on them from their original composition. But there are exceptions. For example, on March 31st, 1965, a large asteroid fell into a lake near Revelstoke, Canada. Let me also point out that asteroids burning up in the atmosphere are called meteors, and those that reach the Earth's surface are called meteorites. Anyway, because the lake where the meteorite fell was so cold, it froze very quickly and was preserved remarkably well. This allowed scientists to study the meteorite and gather valuable information about the early solar system. The famous meteorite was also witnessed by many people who observed its vibrations and smoke when it hit the ground. Researchers were able to go to the site and collect about 7 kilograms of samples, with a 680 gram piece being found nearly perfectly intact because it fell into a haystack. These are critical discoveries. Now, the second way to study asteroids is far more complex and Hollywood-esque. Send a spacecraft to the asteroid to collect samples. You can imagine how difficult that is. First, an interesting asteroid candidate has to be found, and its orbit must be precisely determined, so scientists know exactly where and when it will be located. Then, years of research and development follow, and millions of dollars are spent to build a spacecraft. That spacecraft must be launched successfully, which is itself a complicated mission. It must be placed into an orbit that intersects with the asteroid's trajectory, reach its target, enter the asteroid's weak gravitational field, land on its surface without breaking apart, and ensure that all instruments on board work properly. Using these instruments, the spacecraft collects samples, takes off again without exploding, and enters a return orbit that will bring it back to Earth. The spacecraft must re-enter the Earth's atmosphere and withstand the intense friction without breaking apart, allowing the samples to be retrieved by scientists and brought to the lab without contamination. It's like a mission, impossible challenge, until Osiris-Rex. Japan was the only country to successfully reach asteroids. The Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency, JAXA, succeeded with the Hayabusa mission in 2010, reaching an asteroid, though it didn't collect the expected samples. In 2018, JAXA's Hayabusa 2 mission succeeded in reaching the Ryugu asteroid, landing on its surface, collecting samples, and returning them to Earth. Osiris-Rex was the United States' first and only successful asteroid mission. Launched on September 8, 2016, Osiris-Rex reached its target asteroid, Bennu, on December 3, 2018. The spacecraft then spent 2 years in orbit around Bennu, using sensors to study its surface. Let me tell you a little bit about Bennu. This asteroid is very interesting. It's only about 490 meters in diameter, which is just 5.5 football fields long, and it's not very compact. Technically, Bennu is a second or even third generation celestial body, formed from the fragments of a larger asteroid that broke apart about 1 to 2 billion years ago. Bennu orbits the Sun at a distance of 0.9 to 1.4 astronomical units, which, if you know a bit about astronomy, is a very close range, and this means it crosses our orbital path. In fact, Bennu is classified as a potentially hazardous asteroid by NASA. We can predict Bennu's orbit with certainty until around 2135. After that, however, due to the three-body problem and other factors, predictions become probabilistic. This means that the gravitational interactions between Bennu, Earth, and the Sun create uncertainties that accumulate over time, leading to less certainty in long-term predictions. As of now, Bennu is not likely to collide with Earth until 2013-50, but from 2017-75 to 2019-99, there is a 37% chance of collision, a significant risk in astronomical terms. More worryingly, there are regions in Bennu's orbit known as gravitational keyholes, which could increase the likelihood of a collision with Earth, especially if Bennu passes through one of these regions around September 25th, 2350. This could bring the chance of collision in 2182 close to 100%. In short, this is extraordinary science. Wouldn't you agree? Now, as for the Osiris-Rex mission's timeline, Osiris-Rex reached Bennu in 2018, spent 2 years studying the asteroid, and finally landed to collect samples in 2020. On May 10th, 2021, it left Bennu and began its journey back to Earth, eventually arriving in September 2023. 2023, the spacecraft released a capsule containing the samples, which successfully landed in Utah, USA. On January 13th, 2024, scientists began analyzing the samples, which turned out to be filled with extraordinary discoveries, including evidence of organic material from space. Some researchers believe life may have originated in space, possibly on an asteroid or another planet, and later been transported to Earth. This supports the panspermia hypothesis, though it still doesn't explain how life originated in the first place. For that, we would need to turn to the theory of abiogenesis, which suggests life evolved from non-living molecules. However, wherever life may have started, the fundamental conditions predicted by the theory of abiogenesis, which is currently the most widely accepted theory of the origin of life, must be met. There must have been an environment that enabled the possibility of a sufficiently diverse organic chemistry, where amino acids, which we know are related to life, and proteins made from them, nucleic acids, and the genetic material they form, such as DNA and RNA, fatty acids, and the lipids they form, and simple sugars, and the complex carbohydrates formed from them, could emerge. In such an environment, we know that cellular structures, which we call coxervates, can form, structures that lie between lifelessness and life. These coxervates, which can isolate themselves largely from the outside world, initiate the life processes we call metabolism by enabling the molecules trapped inside to undergo more selective reactions. Of course, this process may result in numerous failed attempts along the way, but from among them, one or a few may succeed, and this is where the process leading to fully functional life can begin. At least, the most widely accepted theory of life's origin in science is built on this foundation. The significance of this for today's video is as follows. Wherever we find these fundamental molecular structures, they create potential areas where life could begin, and asteroids are now listed among the potential areas where life-related processes could occur, or were, until the Osiris-Rex mission to Bennu. Researchers managed to find 14 of the 20 amino acids that make up life in the 120-gram sample from Bennu. Even more incredibly, they found all 5 of the nucleobases that make up our genes, which we learned in high school: adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine, and uracil, in those samples. Even talking about an asteroid as old as the solar system itself still makes my heart race. Now, here's the thing. 2 of the most important components of life, amino acids and nucleic acids, had been found previously on other celestial bodies in space. For example, the Murchison meteorite that fell in Australia in 1969. In that sample, 70 amino acids, many of which are very rare on Earth, were detected. And of the 5 nucleobases that form the structure of DNA and RNA, only uracil was identified. So, the discovery of Bennu may not be the first, but it is extremely valuable in terms of its richness and the fact that it was directly collected from the asteroid untouched. Not only that, but on the surface of Bennu, 11 different minerals, ranging from halite, rock salt, to sylvite, potassium chloride, including abundant amounts of carbonates, phosphates, sulfates, chlorides, and even small amounts of sodium fluoride, have been found. Now, initially, the relationship between these salts or minerals and life may not be immediately clear, apart from them being nutrients. There are 2 critical points you need to understand here. The first is that these minerals cannot be formed from the reaction of water with rocks in a simple manner. For these to form, water must evaporate. But there are no physical conditions on Bennu's surface where evaporation could occur. The second critical point is the order in which these minerals are arranged on Bennu. Evaporite crystals, the same minerals we see on Earth, also form. For example, in our famous salt lakes, such as Lake Lut and Lake Seals, water evaporates and leaves behind minerals. However, these minerals accumulate in a very specific order. Typically, carbonates like calcite and dolomite precipitate first, followed by sulfates like gypsum and anhydrite, and finally, halite, common table salt, potassium salts, and rarer minerals. The arrangement of minerals found on Bennu is very similar to the evaporite sequences we see on Earth. The way this could happen is that Bennu, or its precursor asteroid, during the early stages of the solar system, experienced high radiation from radioactive sources or collided with other celestial bodies, heating up the water inside, causing it to evaporate. These samples collected from Bennu show that this evaporation scattered through thin fissures and cracks. Minerals have accumulated along these cracks. This suggests that these minerals could have accumulated along small water pools, similar to the lakes and ponds we see on Earth, though not as large. This creates a potential new habitat for life, where life could have started, not just on Earth or other planets and moons, but even on asteroids, from the very early stages of the solar system. Now, if you extrapolate this to the trillions of stars in the universe, and the quadrillions upon quadrillions of asteroids revolving around them, can you understand my excitement? These hypersalty water pools, known as brines, have already been found on the dwarf planet Ceres and Saturn's moon Enceladus. We will soon see if life started there. Moreover, the molecules found on Bennu don't necessarily have to directly start life. Conditions that did not exist on planets like Earth during their early stages could have formed on these types of asteroids, and as a result, new organic molecules that could not form on Earth might have been transported here by asteroids, accelerating the process of life beginning. Asteroids, beyond just life, dramatically increase the possibility of life's early steps and the diversity of life in the universe. What more can I say about this discovery? Of course, we haven't found life in space yet. After all, finding some organic molecule somewhere doesn't mean that life exists or ever existed there. What's exciting here is that millions of data points, which indicate we're on the right track regarding the origin of life, have been significantly expanded by adding this critical new discovery. Thanks to findings like this, our thoughts on abiogenesis, the beginning of life from non-living matter, are becoming clearer, and we can take more accurate next steps in our research. The news from Osiris-Rex regarding BENNU is a huge victory in science's battle against the unknowns of the universe. What comes next will be shown by time and the dedicated scientists who keep working. And I'm sure some of the researchers who will make this breakthrough will be among you. If you liked this video, I definitely recommend watching this one, where I discuss even more things we need to know about space. Until next time, take care.